In our last panel for the day, we will present to you the future of technology. So please welcome on stage the panelists, John Omo, Secretary General, African Telecommunication Union, Adnan Kashwani, Senior Director, Cloud COE, Technology and IT, Ittisalat by IAND, Jan Olsberg, Commercial Director, Vodafone Oman, Alex Chase, Senior Director, AP Telecom, Azam Baig, Principal Consultant, Beyond, and Tameh Badran, Managing Director and EC, GCC. And moderating the session, Rana Sanyura, Partner MENA Strategy and Transactions, TMT Leader, EY. Welcome on stage.
Thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today. Thank you for the panelists. So I'm pleased to moderate this very important session with the distinguished panelists representing different stakeholder groups. Given the diverse background of the panelists, I will be framing the discussion around the five pillars. So mainly the policy and regulations, the capital and funding, the talent and innovation, also the demand decide across segments, as well as infrastructure. There is no particular order, but I wanted that the discussion, the questions will be revolving around those five pillars. Why those pillars? Because they are really crucial in nurturing the technology ecosystem. And by ecosystem, I'm referring to the environment that will enable the advancement of technology in nations, and it will ensure that there is definitely adoption and it is purpose-led, meaning it will be serving our communities and economies, inshallah. So, Mr. Omo, yes. I will start with you. First, I would like to congratulate you on being re-elected as the Secretary General of the African Telecommunications Union.
Thank you.
Overall, you have a quite rich, diverse experience in policy and regulations. It would be great if you can share your perspective on the role of policymakers, regulators, and or unions in nurturing the technology and innovation ecosystem in the different markets.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation and the opportunity to speak to the public on this. I think we need to see policy and regulation as the key driver for the sort of decisions that we make in the ICT industry. Whether from an investment perspective or supply side, the opportunities that are available to us on account of the policy frameworks and regulations that we make then invites investment into ICT and stimulates demand for various ICT products and services. And so the place of policy development and regulation is very important in that regard. From an African perspective, we've seen quite a lot of policy changes in the last couple of years that allow a multi-operator environment in the ICT industry, which is good because then you stimulate competition for various services, and then that drives innovation and the sort and quality of products or services that are offered to consumers. Now, policy making is been traditionally a preserve of governments. I think we are seeing increasingly where there's a lot more stakeholder involvement. So that operators, policymakers, civil society organizations are getting involved in policy making process so that it is not a monopoly of governments or regulators as such. And so it needs to involve all the stakeholders in the ecosystem for it to be acceptable, to be easily implemented. And so I think most of governments in Africa have adopted that approach where policy making is a multi-stakeholder sort of engagement where all the stakeholders are brought together and they discuss what is ideal for the industry with governments, with regulators, and so whatever is adopted is one that suits the environment, stimulating investment, encouraging investments, in networks and also protecting consumers. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. It would be great, Mr. Adnan.
Yeah, I can add. Of course, it's difficult to add after your valuable input. I would say also there is maturity when it comes to regulations, especially when it comes, because we are talking about future technologies. When it comes to a technology which is new, we don't expect 100% maturity from day one. We just need to have the regulations that are must to have, that are good enough to start, launch, and bring investments, as I mentioned. And then it can mature over time. I could even give an example of the public internet that became mainstream worldwide in the early 90s. If you compare the rules and regulations related to internet from 1993, 1994 to today, it will not be the same. Of course, we have much more mature rules, regulations worldwide. That matured over time. But did this stop internet from being a thing in the 90s? No, it did not. So the point I want to make here, in we need to start somewhere. We need rules and regulations that are good enough to start, and then it can mature over time.
And have you faced any obstacles? Because you work across geographies, like obstacles related to regulation, and how do you think we can mitigate those?
Yeah, there will all be, let's say, localized rules and regulations. We cannot avoid this. This is nature of this industry. But there will always be also standards. The more technology is standardized, the easier it is to get across these localized restrictions.
And in terms of E&, I mean, for those who probably don't know E&, so it's Salat by E&, so this is the evolution to a technology company. So we've seen a lot of investments globally by E&, and including investments in startups and technology startups. In terms of priorities for the coming years for E&, what are the areas like future technologies that you're looking into and why?
I would say priorities will be also driven or influenced by the global trends, not only by our own judgment. We are not living alone in the world. Of course, investment in technology and infrastructure to develop the country is never a loss. Some technologies will have ROI or return earlier than the others, and some will take longer time to return, but there will always be return. Now, we have also to look at technology, and also one thing maybe I would say that stopping investment in certain technology, of course, whenever such thing is decided, is not a mistake. Not every technology will reach a level that it will become the next cash cow, as they call it. So it's about putting the right talents in the choices and putting the right, let's say, decisions. Once you put the right people in decision making, you can never fail in this.
Let me just add that technology will always outpace regulation and policy making. And with the new technologies that are getting out of the production line and being tried, there is a sense in which even the bare minimum would not apply. And so we need to have policies that encourage trials and regulatory sandboxes so that inventors, ICT companies and startups are encouraged to try, as long as, of course, what is being tried is not criminal. Allow them to try, test whether it works, see whether there's a business case to it, and when it there's a sense of maturity in it, then you can apply policies and regulations towards that. Indeed, most of the inventions or services that we have developed out of that framework where there was clearly no policy. For example, the M-Pesa services in East Africa was just tried at first, and the policymakers, the regulators allowed it to thrive for a start. And then when it picked up, then there was need to move in and have a policy towards it and regulate it. So there's a sense in which trial is a necessary way in which to encourage development in the ICT industry, and then when there's maturity, then you can get in and regulate or have a policy backdrop. And we've seen quite a lot of that, sandboxes in Africa, for purposes of encouraging investment in technology.
Mm. So I like the comment of allow the culture of trial, because this is innovation. This allows the culture of innovation. Innovate, try, then when you know that this is mature and it can become a real product, then regularize, productize.
Sorry. So we've spoken about innovation and investments. Mr. Jan, from your experience at Vodafone, how can we ensure nobody is left behind out of all of these development in technology and the investments that are happening?
Assalamu alaikum, good afternoon. Look, technology, if it doesn't make a difference for humanity, really means nothing. So at Vodafone, our purpose is that we connect for a better future. And I can share three examples on how we are making a difference in terms of bridging the digital divide. And that first and foremost starts with access. So if you think about Africa in particular, but not exclusively, we still have 2.7 billion people, 2.7 billion people that don't have 3G plus access. And the key determining factor is actually not so much the network, it is actually the device. So we have 2.7 billion people that don't have a smartphone. So one of the initiatives that we have been driving together with the ITU, together with the UN, is to find ways that we provide access in the African continent for affordable smartphones. Now, affordable smartphones, once in the hands of the people, and we heard earlier on today about the dimension of what it means for women in households to make a difference from a socio-economical perspective, is a big deal. Now, how can that be achieved? One is all about affordability. And affordability comes from new and innovative financing modeling. John might know from Kenya that Safaricom offers a high frequency but low amount level financing, so that you can really ensure that smartphones are in everybody's hand. So once you have achieved that, you have a complete enabler to drive these ecosystems that were just discussed. And I just came across a very interesting statistic that connectivity is not so much the issue. 95% of the 2.7 billion that I was just mentioning actually have access to networks, but they don't have access to a 3G plus smartphone. So access to devices is number one. Two, and I will again bring in an example from the African continent, is all around starting to take the next step in the ecosystem, which is fintech. So we have launched, from a Vodafone global services perspective, M-Pesa in most of the countries. Again, I read that in Kenya, 90% of the households use M-Pesa. I don't know if John uses M-Pesa, I hope so. And that made a huge difference, because suddenly rural communities that were not banked before now have access to procuring water, selling goods and services, buying electricity on a prepaid basis. So it really shows nicely how connectivity with M-Pesa combined really makes a big difference for the local communities. However, there's one more topic which I think is more recent and quite interesting, and that is the example currently of Europe and specifically the United Kingdom. I don't know if it's very top of mind here in the Emirates, but in Europe right now we are seeing a significant economical downturn and a recession. And a recent study in the UK has indicated that 75% of the households have a concern in terms of cost of living, driven by inflation, driven by energy prices. So this is a significant concern. And Vodafone has now started to lead initiatives around social broadband. So that means that people who are in need, they can get special access to including even small and medium companies that get broadband and mobile connectivity for up for a year for free. Why? Because if, and you mentioned it nicely, we leave people behind, and if we take the choice not to address that digital divide, then we won't see the opportunities, we won't see the innovation that was just mentioned, and we also won't see the monetization. So taking swift action in the different geographies to make sure that people who are not connected right now, or people who can't afford to be connected, getting access, I think that is a priority number one.
Thank you very much. So it's interesting, the contrast between continents and segments. So we're seeing like 3G, barely having access to 3G, while we're now talking about 5G, advanced, 6G. I don't know, Mr. Tamer, if you can, like the slow adoption of 5G is not to mention, you know, trying to come up with, you know, monetization opportunities for 6G and, you know, justifying any investments in 6G. Do you see any role for Open RAN in the advancements of technology and the commercial deployment?
Yeah, definitely. So actually, you know, we have talked about Open RAN now for last 3-4 years. It was like a dream to open the RAN and start having a multi-vendor ecosystem in the RAN domain. So from my perspective, Open RAN is like it's a national security. So you have to have segmentation, you have to have multi-vendor, you have to open, and you know, the openness itself come with innovation. So when we have open interfaces, we open the door for entrepreneur. We open the door for startups who build edge applications to come and do new innovative services. It enabled the smart and safer cities. You know, one of the major challenges for safer cities today and smart cities is edge infrastructure. There is no enough cloud in each edge. In NEC, we have been involved in several initiatives of national-based safer city initiatives. And one of the challenges was edge infrastructure. How can we reach to every, next to every door, next to every consumer? We come across many innovative edge applications, but there is no infrastructure, there is no foundation. So I believe it has to be collaborative efforts from the telecom service provider, from the regulators, from the city infrastructure and the municipalities to enable this move. It will contribute even to the economy from the return of encouraging the startups and entrepreneurs to go and build their service next to the RAN. And specifically in terms of 6G contribution, you know, Open RANs come with intelligent where we name it in technology like radio intelligent controller, where it will be the foundation for 6G, because this is the part where have all the intelligence, analytics part, get data from the every site and analyze it and start to give recommendations. And those data will help the application provider in the edge. So overall, Open RAN will be a big contributor. It just need collaborative efforts from all the stakeholders in order to happen. Because as for example, Adnan said, it needs some time for maturity. It needs some time for adoption. So if the community, if the telco industry didn't give that chance, enough chance and time for the maturity, it will not happen. And it's not fair to judge about it compared to a very traditional, mature, 30 years of accumulated vendor locked stack. Where it's a new story and it needs its time for maturity, but definitely it will help in the evolution and the 6G and the city evolution. It will help in all aspects.
From your experience, how can we actually accelerate the adoption and what could be the drivers? And you mentioned policy, let's say regulations. Are there any other factors or drivers that we can think of, maybe funding, governance, security?
Yeah, you know, what I see, for example, from our global experience is it goes fast from in the country where the regulatory started to support, the government itself started to mandate the openness, started to fund initiatives for like building an open lab and enable the interoperability between the traditional RAN vendors and the open RAN vendors, and they bring them to work together. So regulatory is quite important, and government sponsorship is quite important. There is also a part for the communication service provider to give it a chance for maturity time. For they need to look to the TCO for like 5-6 years, including the benefits of 6G. including the benefits of having the edge infrastructure and the edge applications will come as on top after building the foundation. So like when you look to a quick win, fairly, I don't see quick win. It need time. But when you look to the 5-7 years TCO, definitely it bring big value. It bring new business, new revenue stream, new business line. It also bring innovation. It build the foundation for the future. And it build competition in the market. So instead of closing the door for 3-4 choice, you could have 20-30 choice, which benefit the national security and the country itself.
Rana, just let me interfere here.
Please.
I fully tend to agree with Tamer. So living in the UK, working primarily with UK-based operators, if I look back into 10, 15 years ago, many tier one operators in the UK, they started to share their RAN. For example, like the Bacon program, which Jan maybe know about, between Telefonica and Vodafone. We didn't have Open RAN. The Open RAN was not even a discussion 15 years ago. However, these companies, they realized the economical benefits of sharing the RAN, the high coverage they can reach out to, higher number of population, higher number of subscribers. Later on, with the evolution of the technology, we even realized and we came to learn quickly, if we use the kernel and we open the kernel and we start using the commodity hardware across those operators, then we can achieve even further better enhancements and operational cost savings.
It's good you brought up the, you know, the UK experience. Do you see this happening soon in this part of the world as well?
Yes, definitely. So Tamer also mentioned about the government. So the UK government, for instance, they made it obligatory for all the operators in the UK that 30% of their networks to be running on Open RAN network by 2030. So all the efforts in the UK, and even now Europe is following the same, they have to open their network by 2030.
If I can just comment about the region here, because I'm physically part of this region. So thanks to Salat by EAN, they were like in 2019, they trusted and they take the risk and they started the trials with NEC like 4 years back. It was very early days and we done a successful trial together even before 5G in the 4G. I see several initiatives in the region and the GCC consortium of the major telco provider in the region to collaborate together in helping the scale to happen. Because to give the chance to Open RAN, we need a scale. So there are several initiatives in the region with collaborative effort from the, all the big telco in the region to support the moves to Open RAN. It's not easy. It needs time, it needs investment, it needs maturity. But I see lots of serious move recently in every country in the region.
So I think we talk a lot about investment and we talk a lot about maturity. Another important topic for 5G is monetization. So 5G is a reality. Actually, if I may say, in the Emirates is certainly impressive. Yeah, it's ubiquitous and so it is across the Gulf. So before we talk about 6G, I think the real conversation needs to be for enterprise and consumers that how do we really capitalize on the investments that we have made on 5G. Now, if you look at infrastructure, if you look at government, if you look at enterprise application, on-site, robotics, applications that need no low latency, where we can also benefit from different classes of service, 5G slicing, etc. There are enormous amount of opportunities in the industry to monetize 5G. However, if we look at the consumer side, I think we as an industry so far have failed, other than running big marketing campaigns, putting 5G on billboards, to actually really create a benefit. Because what you will find, certainly, in most of the networks, is that very often 5G speeds are actually even slower than 4G. And if I think about my own family, if I take, the car, and I drive from Muscat to Dubai, what do we care about, We want to watch Netflix in the backseat, and we want to watch that without service interruption. That matters much more for consumers than, the latency of 4 milliseconds on 5G. So I think from an industry and large enterprise perspective, governmental applications, we are there. But the dialogue with the consumer in terms of really bringing 5G benefits to everybody, that's something we need to do.
No, definitely. Thank you very much, everyone. Alex, I think like talking about the everyone, like digital inclusion, can you please share with us and the audience the role of you know, the submarine cables, because we have seen a huge growth recently in the market. And how do you see it, you know, tackling the digital inclusion aspect given recent investments in the satellite space as well?
Yes. Well, submarine cable, we're discussing 5G, 6G, a lot of talk about the metaverse over the past 2 days. It's the lifeline of all of it. To do anything internationally has to run on the submarine cable. So it's very important that we are predicting the trends happening and are building the capacity to do so, making sure that there is enough dark fiber to sustain this massive increase of development, and also making sure that on the submarine cable systems themselves, we're building in possibility for upgrade. So while we always don't know what the future technology, I mean, to some extent, we can estimate, but we still don't know what comes around in a year, two, three. But building the cable systems in a way that can be adjusted and can be upgraded will drive the inclusivity of all these different products we're talking about. In terms of, and I really appreciated what you were discussing earlier about, you know, education and how there's such limited access still. It's more critical than ever to make sure that we are building these subsea cables to formerly forgotten or not, they weren't in the priorities at the time, these countries. AP Telecom is very committed to serving these underdeveloped markets and to bringing them up to speed with the rest of the world, so that things like education, things like jobs, everything that drives an economy are able to happen.
Yes, and in terms of, you mentioned, you know, talent or like education as a, as an area. So I would like to go back to you, Mr. Omo. How do you see the role of ATU in, you know, developing the human capital across the continent in Africa?
Thank you very much. I think Africa globally has probably the youngest population, and that comes with great potential in terms of the capacity of young people to innovate, to get onto the grid, and to use ICT systems and services. At a number of our governments, based on the African Union's digital transformation strategy, have adopted, you know, a couple of e-skilling initiatives at the national levels and of course at the continental level based on the African Union digital agenda. And so plugging into that, we have you know, had a study as the ATU in terms of the sort of skilling and skill sets that we need in the continent, and also the gaps that exist, quite a lot of, you know, linkages between ministries in charge of education and ministries in charge of ICT and industry. A lot of skill sets that we develop in our educational institutions do not match what industry is looking for. And so industry has had to retool and reskill these people to get into the job market. So most of the training institutions in Africa have coming up with new skill and curriculum for purposes of ensuring that those coming out of our tertiary institutions and educational institutions are fit for purpose and can get into the market straight away. And I think that is the biggest opportunity that exists there in terms of those who want to invest in e-education and e-skilling in Africa. I know for reasons of time, I may not get another bite on this, but there's great investments in e-skilling and education in using ICT in Africa that I think is a tremendous opportunity for those that are looking for new greenfields for investment in Africa. Thank you.
I think we're doing great on time, right? We're fine.
All right.
No, we're fine, and we'll leave room okay, for questions from the audience.
Okay.
But if you want to add anything, sorry. Do you want to add anything?
No, go ahead. I hope I can come back to it again.
Education again, I think I'd like to add also that the pandemic time was a great learning experience. Mm-hmm. The pandemic time affected also, it showed the importance of how important it is to have the infrastructure strong, because countries with higher or stronger infrastructure were able to continue the education for all, let's say, age groups without any interruption. But in many, let's say, less fortunate parts of the world, there was some interruption in education. There were kids who missed a full year. That did not happen where the telecom and the links and the connectivity part was strong enough to handle. Plus, it influenced also the classification of what's important to study for the kids going to colleges and universities and all that. I personally know people who change their field after the pandemic to choose something related more to technology. Mm. And it was my influence also, but it was there.
Yes. I would like to, Azam, I understand you're also involved in training, upskilling. Can you share more information on that, please?
Absolutely, yeah. From different digital transformation programs that we run globally, the most and the highest and the biggest frequent challenge that we hear is educating people, is the cultural shift, is the mind shift. So we developed a program which is tailored based on every digital transformation. It's very specific. But mainly the most common components of this framework is accessibility as a first phase. The second phase is educate. The third phase is trust. And then from there, the whole digital transformation for the people and for the digital inclusion starts accelerating. When we talk about accessibility, we are not making the products that we build proprietary. We rather open them. We build a community version. We allow people. So from vendor perspective, our users is the operator. So we allow the operator to use our community version, open, free of charge, to test and try and learn. That's one step. From this very basic step, then it goes to the next, which is educate. We start educating on more advanced features, higher capabilities of machine learning, for instance, and automation. And the last stage is once they start building the trust, this is where we kind of hire champions of automation, champions of machine learning, who are able to adopt this technology, and then they accelerate the learning across the entire organization within the opcos. And I think this model worked very well for us in the past 2-3 years.
Mm-hmm. But in terms of this region, again, I mean, this is happening in the probably UK, US, right?
It happened in the UK, it happened in the US, but also it's happening in Qatar as well.
In
Middle East, Qatar.
Okay. So in terms of, I mean, we have the knowledge sharing, but more importantly, the local content creation in this part of the world. What do you think should be done to increase that?
Maybe my colleagues touched a little bit on some of the subjects, but if I'm to address it or rephrase it, I would say a consortium of different operators collaborating, researching, writing white papers, and having their teams actually collaborating. Tamer mentioned parts of that is being done with Etisalat. I think replicating that model with other operators across the Gulf, it will accelerate the adoption of digital technologies.
Mm-hmm. Okay, interesting. You mentioned like some white papers. It seems like you're quite involved as well in research and development and new white papers coming up in 2023.
Correct.
Can you please tell us more about this thought leadership and what was driving this new thought leadership, if you can, please?
It goes into...
If it's not confidential yet.
No, it's absolutely not. We can talk about it, but it's a personal scar that I have in my heart about the telecom industry. You know, back in the 90s or early 2000s, it was very cool for someone to hear that he's working telecom company. I remember my father or my cousins like, yeah, he's an engineer, he works in telecom company. It was something wow. Nowadays, working in telecom, like people put their hands down. Like, it's really tough. The new wow thing nowadays is working for Facebook, for Microsoft, the Google things. The digital transformation, unfortunately, in the past 18 years was very slow. It needs to be accelerated. And I have a fear that by the time the telecom actually transforms, there will be another technology like metaverse that will eat the market share. This is quite risky for us in the telecom. We have to come up with innovation. We have to be fast in the way we innovate, not only on the technology side, but also in terms of monetization and selling use cases. So the next white paper that I'm writing, and I already started, is talking about network lifecycle management, how we can accelerate the operation and the technology adoption. You have the concept that's being built in the pre-production in the lab. Then usually the silo is, and the processes are broken. You have to repeat the same process 3 months or 6 months in the production. Instead of doing that, we're bringing the production and the pre-production together. We integrated with the CI/CD pipelines, DevOps engineers. So whatever is being built in the pre-production is being reutilized again in the production. Therefore, it accelerates the time to market. And the next thought leadership paper, it will be about this topic.
Okay, great. Any views from the telco operators?
Yeah, I can add maybe to this. First of all, one of my kids wants to work in a telco operator, so maybe I will not fully agree to work. Okay, so it's telecom operators globally are, let's say, profit-making organizations. Yes, many of them will be co-owned or partially owned by governments, but they are still there to provide certain value or service to customers to get ROI. And there are two schools of thought about when to invest. Whether to invest first and spend the money and avail the service and then wait for demand, or the safer option to wait for demand and then avail, and by then you are maybe late in many cases. I would quote Henry Ford here, the one who made Ford company of cars, that if I asked customers about their demand, they would have asked for a faster horse. Okay, so customer demand is good, but if you give the, let's say, if you direct your customer demand, then you ensure that you get the customer, you have the first mover advantage, you are early to the market, you are stronger in terms of competition. So this is why we are rebranding our name, you can say, and all that, because we want to be pioneers. We don't really want to be late to the game.
Yeah, let me echo that, and maybe also say if your son is interested, you know, Oman, Greenfield, startup, you know, interesting employer.
He's 8 years old.
Oh, you have okay, to wait a maybe little. We wait a little bit. No, look, I mean, if you think about the evolution, and I think digital maturity was already discussed, I think it's quite interesting to consider that first we looked at communication, and then if you look at smartphone uptake in the consumer space, certainly right now, you will see that social media penetration is around 95-96% in the GCC. But that doesn't mean digital maturity, that doesn't mean digital savviness. Yeah? What we have seen, and you mentioned already, is during the pandemic, we've basically outgrown that and we moved from social media adoption to e-commerce. So e-commerce obviously has exploded in lack of better alternatives, and that has created a whole new ecosystem, yeah? And an amazing amount of relevant use cases for mobility and of course fixed broadband equally. And now the next stage will be quite interesting to see how hybrid models, you know, also the metaverse will actually find adoption, or, and Leslie from Nokia talked about that yesterday as well, is it a little bit overhyped, certainly for consumers? Yeah. So very often we set the metaverse as equal with Meta from Facebook. We think it's about VR goggles, and it's really not. It's a whole new ecosystem that includes payment, that includes security, and that includes a different way of working. And I think this will really be interesting now, from communication over social media, over e-commerce, moving into that new world that needs to be enabled, certainly, by us, because we are providing the infrastructure.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Sorry, Alex, you wanted to add anything?
I think he makes a tremendous point on specifically the metaverse. A lot of people think that, you know, it's the vision of Mark Zuckerberg where everybody's putting on headsets and we're essentially doing what we're doing here, but in our homes, but we're in a virtual reality room going on. And that's, even if let's say that comes into fruition in some form, that's just such a small percentage of what the metaverse actually is. It's healthcare, it's economies, it's monetary transactions, it's fintech, and again, all running on submarine cable.
Well, I will challenge you here a little bit. Do you see any threat happening from the satellite, especially now the investments happening in the satellite business?
Yeah, specifically on satellite, I think a preconceived notion is that there is a battle between satellite and subsea cable, and one wants to take over the other, and that's just not the case. They're a very complementary business. In order for the satellite to do its job, the subsea cable has to provide the connectivity. You know, in the U.S., Starlink is a very popular thing that's coming about. I can actually get Starlink television in my neighborhood if I choose to do so. But you know, subsea cable is the way, the base, the connection, and then the Starlink or any kind of satellite system is a way to improve the access and connection that we're all discussing here within you know, area regions.
We have to mention the difference also between the access. The word access is key. That between the access layer and the core or backbone layer. So backbone will always depend on submarine, at least for the near future that we foresee. But the access layer might have some more varieties, I would say.
Yeah, I think taking into consideration a continent as big as Africa, where large swathes of the landmass is inhabited by very few people, we will still for some time rely on satellite you know, resources for purposes of connecting those small villages that are outside the terrestrial grid. And so we are working with the satellite industry. Indeed, most of the terrestrial based investments in Africa rely quite a bit on satellite. But taking his point earlier on COVID and the opportunities that it has established, especially for the satellite industries in Africa for delivering education, is tremendous. And I think, as he says, these are complementary technologies, not competing, of course, in terms of resources. Sometimes there's sibling rivalry in terms of spectrum, which is expected. But I think there's quite a lot of complementarity. And for a continent as big as Africa, there's quite a bit of reliance on satellite resources for purposes of access. Thank you.
That is excellent.
What we probably need to see a lot more is industry working together on lowering, you know, satellite-based terminals for purposes of access. Thank you.
I think in addition to satellite, something specific to Africa also, several countries do not have access to the coast. So you will be relying, I mean, it's easier and more economical to rely on satellites versus landlines.
So we'll open the floor for any questions from the audience. Anyone has any question? I'm sure there is. Sorry. Okay, do we have a mic, please?
Yes.
Right, great discussion. I don't know if the gentleman in the brown suit is a Tamil.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, the one next to you, sorry.
Okay. Next to him, Azam.
You made a great point about telecoms in terms of how cool and sexy it was in the past, and now it's becoming a little depressing. But I think you should also maybe factor in the fact that now Facebook, Google, and these guys are letting go of people. It's a really good time for telecoms to attract that talent and sort of upgrade their positioning in the value chain. Have you any thoughts on that?
Yes, it's a very good point that you mentioned. And I was about to make a comment, and that comment will answer yours. Rana, on the panel, we spoke about the 5G Advanced, we spoke about Metaverse. If you think about the publicity of Metaverse, it started way earlier than the ability of the telecom infrastructure to actually deliver it. 5G can deliver AI, can deliver virtual reality, augmented reality, but it will not be able to deliver the metaverse. Metaverse is planned to be delivered by 2030, which is with the launch of 6G, because the requirements of the 6G are much higher than 5G. But why the publicity of metaverse started now? if you brainstorm it and start criticizing the telecom industry, and we are honest with ourselves, we will understand, or it's my thought here, I might be wrong, but the metaverse is looking and understand, they understand that at some point, telecom industry will transform, will softwareize, but they will not be able to sell metaverse. Therefore, we're going back to the same economical and competition game that we had with Facebook in the past, with over-the-top players. Instead of having YouTube, Facebook, and so on, we have the metaverse. The point you raised now is a very brilliant point, because we have to utilize having those talents coming from Facebook and Google and the likes. We have to hire them, embed them, and help to and ask them to help us accelerate that transformation journey.
Yeah, and then maybe I would also address the notion of the reality of working at a tech co or at Etisalat or at Vodafone, for example. It's incredibly exciting, but what we need to bear in mind is that the industry is at a different stage of maturity. So what I've been at Vodafone for 25 years, so I joined when I was 19 years old, and it has been extremely exciting since. But what you can see is that after these turbulent teens, if you wish, the ultra-fast growth, the harsh competition, the focus from businesses on the quarter rather than on the financial year or years and so forth, we have outgrown that. We are really clear on the purpose that we have in society. It's exciting to see what impact we make. And I think if you now reflect on where to work, I mean, it has never been more exciting than to work at one of these companies, because not only the demand is exploding, it's actually increasing exponentially in terms of our services, but the impact that we are making on society is so much greater. So what I would say that, yes, there's a different level of maturity and a different level of understanding what we do for society, but that hasn't diminished the excitement at all.
I fully agree. I would like us to add also that the importance of partnerships here. Yes, we do have exciting, let's say, role to do in new technologies like Metaverse, but we don't work in silos. Metaverse is, and any new future technology or any new technology requires partnership, requires the right partners to build the correct ecosystem. We were showing, we had two showcases in GITEX about Metaverse. One was with, one was about a retail experience. It was with a partner. The other one was an official partnership with the HTC about E&D Universe, and it was hosted in Mars, not in planet Earth. So in the Metaverse, it was not the real Mars.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you can see all these showcases, although they are, let's say, limited in size because they are showcases, they are not productized, but they are with partners. That shows in such, let's say, adoption will create an ecosystem with the right partners. I hope this answers your question.
Any other questions or remarks? Please.
Thank you very much for this discussion. Actually, it's very, very interesting, especially the last point about the telecom's position within the whole ecosystem. Just one quick brief, I would like to hear your thoughts about that. Talent is one thing, of course, that we need to overcome this challenge, but also who manages or who drives the market is usually defined by who is closer to the consumer. So telecos used to drive it before because it was the handsets were the closest thing to the consumer. And then came the OTTs with the apps and everything, so it came closer to the consumer because it's much closer. Now talk about Metaverse and VR, for example, but I mean, whoever is close to the consumer can drive actually the market. So the question is, yes, we can have talents from these kind of innovative companies. Yes, we can have partnerships, but how can we be positioned in a way that we can actually drive a value to the consumer versus other players who are now defined as more or closer to the consumer? How can we innovate in this kind of business modeling, pricing, this kind of thing? So I would like to hear your thoughts about that. Thank you very much.
Okay. Maybe I can start. Now, going to the consumer can have two paths. One is going directly to the consumer to address the consumer sector as is, and this can be by either adding the retail experience, adding, introducing apps and applications related to the consumer for his or her daily life. Consumers, they don't really adopt technology for the sake of technology. That's only a bunch of geeks, very few of them.
Majority will adopt to have daily life impact, to have some value in their daily life. And this is why smartphones became very popular, because they added that part. And because they came in the right time when the network was ready and applications were available and the full ecosystem was built. This is one way of addressing the consumer. The other way of addressing the consumer, especially for telco, is being an enabler. Telcos have certain advantages that make them a perfect enabler. Telcos today, they have the connectivity. They have the, agreements with the headset or handset makers. And as you said, the VR is one way only. There is also the AR through the mobile phones. There is Web 3.0. Different ways. VR is just one element of accessing the metaverse. So having B2B dealership, partnerships, again, I'm emphasizing the word partners, having the right partnerships with application also, not only the headset makers, will mean also that you can reach the same consumers in a different way, indirectly.
Adnan, if I may add, if you think about your point around positioning in the value chain, that almost feels like a discussion from 10 years ago. Yeah. So if you think about the emergence of OTT, IP players, etc., that's something that we would have debated in this round 10 years ago. Now we have matured as an industry, and our role, as you just mentioned, is incredibly exciting. We are a marketplace. We have a direct relationship with the consumer. We have a billing relationship with the consumer. We have an incredible amount of data points above and beyond any other entity that would exist in the world. And we haven't even started, to tap into that strength. Just to give you a feeling, we are in the customer's pocket every day. So people check the Etisalat app, the Vodafone app. I have the statistics multiple times per week. So the relationship that we have with consumers right now, in terms of billing, in terms of customer service, the role we play in people's life is incredible. So the future looks bright. And yes, the OTT discussion again feels a little bit like yesterday's news.
I think also that, today mobile number become kind of identity. So you cannot really live without it. And emotionally, in the consumer mind, I feel safe with the provider in my country, which he follows the regulations. If I do electronic payments through this provider, if something went wrong, I know where to go. So there is also some part related to the security and safety of where I will feel safe with the provider who's next to me. I can reach the store in a few minutes. I know where to complain if something goes wrong. So that's an important part also in that.
I like this
equation.
Point because giving the example of UAE today, for example, there is the application of UAE Pass. It is your digital identity.
Yeah.
One way to log into UAE Pass is your phone number.
It's your phone number,
shows
right.
Shows that the telco is actually your already, the trusted custodian of your identity.
I think about it slightly differently.
Yeah. Go ahead.
The way I see it.
I'm supporting you.
Maybe I'm complimenting what you're saying. Well, I can rephrase it. So, again, to answer your question, I will ask you back. Do you remember when Metaverse was first introduced? What did Mark do with Facebook? He changed the brand. It's very simple. This is brand awareness and the brand strength that it has, and the brand impact on consumer is massive. For many years now, since the foundation of
your
telecom,
category,
the consumers know Vodafone, Etisalat, and the likes as a voice and data providers. They don't know them as TV services or applications or Uber and so on. The fastest way to change that and to start monetizing from the business perspective, rebrand yourself. Instead of selling that business line under Etisalat name, for instance, just create a new cool name under that brand and start selling and reach out to the same consumers. And this is a very fast and very strong way how you can actually influence the people and start selling new use cases.
Please. Our time is out, but I think final takeaways, please.
Thank you very much. I see our time is up, but I'm a merchant for Africa, and it would be remiss of me if I didn't say this.
Mm-hmm.
There are indeed tremendous investment opportunities in the continent, and Africa is still virgin in a number of areas, but suffice to say that looking at the statistics, the access issue is still an opportunity for organizations that are willing to invest in the continent. For example, just about half a billion has access, and this is projected to grow by 100 million in a year or two. But quite a number of people still have 2G. And so organizations that would invest in terminals that are affordable for that population that would like to get onto the grid using 3G, 4G, and 5G, but at rates that are affordable, would have tremendous investment opportunities in the continent. And of course, also the backhauling still has. But the other thing I see in the continent is virtually all our governments are attempting to have data localization. And if you consider that Africa, the entire African continent, the area for local data centers is equivalent to what Switzerland has. So Africa has about 140,000 meter square of data space in terms of data centers, similar to what Switzerland has. Now, with increasing data localization and new applications coming on board, most of the African governments are having initiatives for
that. That
is sub-Saharan. And so tremendous opportunities in terms of establishment of data centers in the continent exist. I thought, without saying that, I would lose my job. For organizations that are looking forward to investment opportunities, those are some of the areas. There are, of course, others, but I think the access bit in terms of people getting onto the grid is still quite an opportunity there. And of course, with data localization, most of our governments have worked on policies to encourage data localization, and I think there's tremendous opportunities for investment in that area. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Any other final notes? Okay. Thank you very much to the panelists.